Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Could everybody turn off their cell phones, BlackBerries, etc.? Well, welcome to the Council's forum. This is on the record, so you can quote all of the pearls and gems of wisdom you hear from our panel. Before we begin today's program, the Council is pleased to announce that an upcoming meeting, Monday, March 28th, which I guess is this Monday, called Covering Cairo, with Ayman Mojaddin. And if you need more information on that, there's an insert in the back of today's program. We'll tell you about that. So today we're very, very pleased to have three distinguished scholars and observers of Latin America in general and Brazil in particular to talk about Brazil's agenda at home and abroad. And obviously it's a timely meeting given that our president and Brazil's new president just met over the weekend in the president's first trip to Brazil. The panel is probably well known to this group, but I'll just briefly introduce them from right to left or from your left to right. Kellie Hock is the managing director at McLarty Associates. And in talking to Kellie earlier today, I discovered that we were actually at State together for a period of time, and she also worked for USTR. Riordan Roett, I'm sure anybody who pays attention to Brazil knows Riordan. He's the director of the Western Hemisphere program at the Nitze School of Advanced International Studies at Johns Hopkins. He just produced a great new book on Brazil that the Brookings Institution published, and I think he was Julia's professor, which is why Julia's so smart.
If that were the case.
Julia Sweig is also well known to any group that pays attention to Latin America. She's the Nelson and David Rockefeller Senior Fellow and Director for Latin American Studies at the Council on Foreign Relations. So we're delighted to have all three of them here. You know, you may not know, but Nelson Rockefeller actually created the position of Assistant Secretary of State for the Western Hemisphere, and he was the first occupant of that office. And when I was at the State, they had all the photos of my predecessors on the wall, and I'd look at them in the conference room, and the only one anybody ever heard of or remembered was Nelson Rockefeller. So
until you.
Well, unfortunately, including me. So let me just kick this off with an observation. In 1997, the Thai baht collapsed, and followed by the Korean won, and then the Russians defaulted on their sovereign debt, and a currency crisis rippled through the emerging markets and hit Brazil particularly hard. The real collapsed, fell in value by about 50%. Fast forward a decade, the global financial crisis, Lehman Brothers collapsed. Brazil was affected, but far less so. Brazil weathered the financial crisis far better than the United States and Europe, and is recovering far more rapidly. And in the tale of those two crises is sort of a metaphor for the transformation of Brazil that we've witnessed over the last 10 years. The old saw about Brazil was Brazil was the country of the future and always will be, but nobody's saying that anymore because the future is here and it's rapidly emerging. As you know, Brazil is the largest exporter in the world today of ethanol, beef, tobacco, coffee, sugar, chicken. It's the seventh largest economy in the world. About 30 million of its citizens have risen from poverty into the middle class in the last decade. Brazil is a player on most global issues, whether the financial architecture, as a member of the G20, climate change, the Doha round. Brazil is emerging as a player in peacekeeping in Africa and in Haiti, where it leads the peacekeeping effort. It's a significant voice on nuclear proliferation. It's a player, and increasingly in UN forums, and clearly has aspirations to emerge from an inward-looking country 10, 15 years ago to a country that has much higher aspirations to play a role in the global architecture of the 21st century. I think all three, or at least two of our panel members, were down in Brazil during the president's recent visit. So maybe I'll just start the conversation with a question for Riordan. You know, what did Dilma's government want out of this trip? What did the Obama administration want out of this trip? And did either succeed? And, you know, what's your judgment of the effectiveness of the trip? All of these trips have a value just because it's important for the President of the United States to show up and show interest and attention in another nation, and that shouldn't be discounted. But there were probably very high hopes for this trip, and I'd be interested first from you, Riordan, and then Kellie and Julia, maybe to chime in.
A picture's worth a thousand words. There is President Dilma and President Obama. The chemistry was extraordinary from what I could see on television. And more importantly, nobody was expecting any great breakthroughs on this trip. What we were trying to do with the Brazilians and the Americans was to put the last 2 years of the Lula administration behind us. Those 2 years were not good. Dilma is not a clone of Lula. Dilma is the president of Brazil, and she made it very clear in what was reported during the visit that there are certain issues on which she and President Lula disagree, but more importantly, we're looking forward, not backward. And I think the Obama administration understood that very well. And the message that was put out during the meetings, and Kellie can comment on the private sector meeting she was at in Brasilia, which I was not at, was extraordinary. And I did get to go to the Teatro Municipal in Rio for President Obama's speech. And the enthusiasm for the administration, the U.S. administration, was palpable. And the president responded in turn. He actually spoke some Portuguese, which is not an easy thing to do. Alô, cidade maravilhosa, he started his speech, which took about 3 minutes of applause and shouting and that kind of thing. And Mrs. Obama as well, and her stops came out with a couple of words in Portuguese in Brasilia as well. So they made a very, very important effort, I think, to begin again the U.S.-Brazilian relationship.
Commenting on the private sector aspect of the trip, it was also very positive. In great part, I think, because, as Riordan said, you know, both governments wanted this to be extremely positive. Both private sectors did as well. And I thought it was interesting that due to the pressures of the Middle East and Japan, when there was some wavering or nervousness as to whether or not President Obama would come, you know, you saw messages out of the White House that, well, this is an economic trip, this is a jobs trip. You know, which was not as well received in Brazil as perhaps it would be received in Ohio. But, you know, even at that, you know, you really saw, at least amongst the private sector participants, a real feeling that, you know, the most important deliverable of this trip is exactly as Riordan said, getting the relationship back on the rails, that, you know, there's so much that's going on between our countries bilaterally, commercially, as far as enhanced investment by Brazilian companies in the United States, and continued very, very strong enthusiasm by U.S. companies in Brazil, that, you know, no matter what came out of the trip as far as concrete economic deliverables for either side, because Dilma and the Brazilians had their share of rhetoric on the commercial side as well, as far as the need to, you know, break down U.S. trade barriers, et cetera. But really, you know, I think for both the governments and for the private sectors that were there, the most important success out of the trip was the success of getting the relationship back on track. Also, just a quick footnote, one thing that I thought was interesting was on the private sector delegation, you saw a huge number of small and medium-sized companies of the United States interested in Brazil. And for all the years, 11 years in the private sector and 9 in the government before that, that I've been working on Brazil, I've never seen that much interest by, you know, kind of middle America, small and medium-sized companies in this market, and I think that that's a very interesting thing to watch going forward.
So, Julia, in addition to the atmospherics and the private sector, there have been and remain big commercial trade issues that have divided the U.S. and Brazil, particularly U.S. agricultural subsidies in the Doha Round, our prohibitions or tariffs on Brazilian ethanol, sugar-based ethanol. Is there any likelihood that this new relationship that the two leaders have proclaimed is going to lead to any concrete changes in those sore points as we move into an election year, or are we going to take Brazil to the mountaintop, but not really show them the promised land.
Well, I think you might have answered your own question, Bernie.
Sorry.
but I would say, and just to follow up on this, I had been in Brasilia just a week or 10 days prior to the visit and met with a number of cabinet-level ministers and sub-cabinet, and the message was very clear and very uniform about the intent coming directly from Dilma to get the relationship on a positive and better track on a number of fronts. That was absolutely uniform. There was also a lot of clarity, I think, in Brasilia about the limitations for the United States with respect to domestic politics, with respect to our own efforts to still reconstruct from the global financial crisis and how it's hit, with respect to the election. So I think there's a sort of realism about the limits with respect to trade, tariffs, and those grinding structural obstacles. And having said that, what I think we don't know yet is really whether the kind of new and elevated level of dialogue between the two presidents, leaving the Congress aside, is going to really filter into the bureaucracies, both in Brasilia and in Washington. There are 10 memorandums of understanding, new agreements, dialogues on half a dozen different issues, all of which the two countries need to do to kind of create a basis for making the case, both domestically in Brazil and here in the United States, that greater connectivity is in one another's interests. So I think that the question now is what we do see from President Obama and what kind of sort of senior level coordination we get here, and attempt to tell Brazil's story and why Brazil's success is in the U.S. success, in the U.S. interest. That kind of energy and momentum coming out of the White House and the State Department going forward is really what I think we need to watch, because that will define whether we can get past the domestic political obstacles.
So let me ask each of you a related question, which is, you know, Brazil has been ambivalent about its relationship with the United States over the last decade. In some areas they've cooperated, Haiti in particular, taken on that role, which is not really central to Brazil's security, and it's much more important to us because of the refugee flows and G20. And then on proliferation, on Honduras, on the Colombian defense agreement, Brazil has sort of gone out of its way to not thumb its nose at the United States, but certainly to take a radically different position, you know, welcoming Ahmadinejad with a big embrace. So what kind of relationship does the new Brazil, which you say in your terrific article in Foreign Affairs, has recast itself as a global brand, what sort of relationship does Brazil really want with the United States, or is it still a work in progress?
I think it's very much still a work in progress, but it was made very clear by President Dilma that this will be a relationship of equals, not of a big brother United States and a smaller but growing Brazil. I think that message was well received by President Obama, and I think two issues indicate where there will be some differences, but there is also some concern. One, of course, is the famous UN National Security Council seat for Brazil. I think the president handled it very, very well. He didn't give them the India statement. What he did say, he appreciated the candidacy of Brazil, that Brazil and the U.S. would work to reform the multilateral organizations. Well done, well put, a couple of times in his visit. Second, of course, was China. I mean, the next major trip for President Dilma is not Washington, it's Beijing, for the BRIC summit. And that is something which is of great concern. I was in São Paulo for a Deutsche Bank conference before the visit of the president, and all people are talking about in São Paulo is deindustrialization, that Brazil is being swamped with cheaply made, high-quality products, and the Brazilian industrial base cannot compete. And that is going to be a major issue, along with the appreciation of the currency, of course. So these are major policy questions that the U.S. and Brazil share a concern about China, but we don't have any common answer. And that, it seems to me, is going to be part of this dialogue going forward as President Dilma wrestles with this deindustrialization issue and the currency and how do you stand up to China when it's your major market. You know, so on the one hand, you're selling a great deal of goods, commodities, raw materials to China. On the other hand, you're deindustrializing potentially your own industrial base in Brazil. Very tough policy question for the President.
So, Kellie, let me ask the question a different way. As Brazil becomes more of a global player in all of these forums, is it going to find more areas of coincidence of its interest with the United States, or continue to sort of Chinese menu, find some things where the U.S. and Brazil see eye to eye, and others where it's going to be very much in a different...
I think it'll always be the Chinese menu approach. I mean, I think the Brazilians will always be very careful as to what they see in their interest versus not. But I do think that what Riordan is saying as far as this concern about Brazil and the overall fear about deindustrialization in Brazil does end up having an impact on the way that Brazil views the United States. And if you compare President Lula's first trip to China in his first administration, when he went, and you know the famous quote is he came there with, I think he had, what, about 300 businessmen in tow, and said, you know, China is un shopping de oportunidades. China is a shopping center of opportunities. I think everybody knows that China is probably a lot tougher, including Lula, knows that China is a lot tougher than that, that they are a very complicated country, a very complicated market with which to work. President Dilma, just in her few months in office, has reportedly been holding weekly cabinet-level meetings with those ministers mm-hmm. that are relevant to competitiveness, but competitiveness with a subnote of competing with China and being sure that they are both politically and economically confronting the China threat. So I think that, for me, a number of these dialogues, and I would say particularly, and maybe following up a little bit on what Julia was talking about the realism that exists between, I think, both the United States and Brazil as far as how far we can get on the trade agenda, particularly before we deal with our own farm bill, given that ag subsidies are such an important part of this. I do think that one of the dialogues that at least I hope will be the most useful and the most deployed is the one on financial issues, because that is one where our interests, I think, are quite aligned, given the concerns about the Chinese currency. It is one where we have had irritants, you know, with Minister Montag in the last G20, the finance minister at the last G20 meeting, you know, coining this phrase, currency war, due to our own policies of quantitative easing. It's an area where, again, there's been some roughness around the edges in the relationship, but where, in truth of fact, I think most players who see the full picture do think that there are more convergences than divergences there. So hopefully that's a space where we can explore some more.
Yeah, I do think that the kind of ideological hot points of the last couple of years around the Colombia base agreement, the coup in Honduras, the handling of Iran, my sense was a very clear message that the crucial issues of monetary policy, China, the industrial base, the competitiveness agenda for Brazil, likewise the competitiveness agenda for the United States, which the two are remarkably similar, for President Rousseff are much greater priorities than the tete-a-tetes on the more ideological issues. We've seen just this week or in the last 10 days two very interesting votes by Brazil at the UN Security Council that I think give a sense of what we can maybe expect. With respect to the resolution on Libya, Brazil abstained with an explanation, as Brazil frequently with abstentions publishes an explanation describing the reason for the abstention, worrying about whether the military action might do more damage than good, but in an abstention, not a no. And yesterday, Brazil voted yes on the resolution at the Human Rights Council in Geneva for a special rapporteur for Iran. So I think those two votes give us some sense of priorities internationally, and also Kellie's point is, I think, critical.
I think critical for the audience to understand is that the 8 years of President Lula was driven to a large degree by the ideology of the Workers' Party in terms of foreign policy. And the person to watch is a fellow named Marco Aurelio Garcia, who was the key ideologue in the PT administration and I think was responsible for many of the mistakes that the Lula administration made, Iran, Honduras. You will note that Marco Aurelio spent his time in Cuba before the Obama trip. Once again, the PT ideology is very much alive And Dilma will have to deal with that. She is not a PT ideologue.
But
she
what did
not.
He do in Cuba? He said, we're pulling out our investment, our Petrobras
investment.
So that was pretty important. That was the messenger.
He's not a very good businessman, obviously. But I think if the administration falls back in, and Dilma's had her troubles with the PT, over potential protest before the president's visit, et cetera, she will have to control the PT.
Right.
And that is going to be a key marker, I think, in terms of her own independence and her presidency. And finally, she's going to be an internal president. You know, she has 2014 and 2016 to worry about FIFA and the Olympics. She has extraordinary infrastructure challenges she must undertake. She understands them, but they only have 2.5 or 3 years. And she doesn't have a lot of time to be Mrs. Brick, the way Lula was Mr. Brick during his 8 years. She's going to be the president of Brazil dealing with these issues.
Well, that's always been her brand. I mean, her brand has always been she was the mother of the PAC, which was their infrastructure program, Mai do PAC. When she was the chief of staff for President Lula, and so she very much identifies the President Dilma brand with successful infrastructure projects. So that, and it is what, as Riordan said, what Brazil needs right now. So I think she'll continue to do that.
Is there an internal debate in Brazil about the danger of becoming just a commodity-driven economy? I mean, given the demand from China, India, and elsewhere for and Brazil's vast resources, agriculture, and the like, and now potentially oil. Are they just going to take the money and run, or are they a little bit worried that that will, in some ways, turn them backwards toward a model for Latin America and developing world that they want to transcend?
They're very worried about it. I mean, and I, you know, both the fears of deindustrialization that Riordan referenced that are just rampant throughout the Brazilian private sector. But you see that President Dilma herself is concerned about it, and just this week or next week should be developing a new ministry. Brazil has how many ministries, Riordan?
37, 38 now.
Thank you.
And growing.
And growing, because they now are going to have one for small and medium-sized industry, precisely to try to address this concern. You know, there are others, you know, was recently in China, and the Brazilian ambassador to China, Clodoaldo Ugonei, who's a former trade negotiator, excellent guy, you know, he said, well, look, this is the reality. You know, this is what we do well. This is what they do well. We need to try to build a policy that allows for the relationship to not become too unequal, but we need to accept the reality and move forward. But that's going to be something that policy-wise they've got to grapple with for a while.
But we have to recognize that Brazil is now an agro-industrial power. It is not just picking cotton. It is producing products that are in high demand around the world, and it's being produced with extraordinarily high levels of technology first. Mm-hmm. Second, when the oil comes online, the pre-salt, as it's called in Brazil, in 3 to 5 years, Brazil is going to be an oil giant. Now, how they handle that money, whether they go the Norway way or the Nigeria-Venezuela way, is still a matter of great debate. We hope it's going to be in between, as always in Brazil. Kellie centrista, linha centrista. But those that make a difference in terms of Brazil's development over time. And finally, you know, there is in Congress the legislation for a social trust fund. And Dilma said time and again, I am going to reduce, eliminate poverty with the money from the social trust fund. That's an extraordinary claim.
So, you know, there's an old saying that you're challenged more by success than adversity, which I think is often true. What could go wrong for Brazil in the next decade? Is everything, I mean, what you're saying, what everybody is saying is, you know, they have this huge unlimited future in the 21st century, and they seem to be hitting on all cylinders. Is there anything structurally, politically, otherwise that they should be worrying about? That they are worrying about, or is, you know?
Probably the most dangerous issue is an invasion by Paraguay. but I would
100 years ago.
I would discount that. In our immediate planning at the NIC or National Security Council, whatever the people think about these things, I think that the major issue is, can they handle the economy? I mean, all you got when I was in São Paulo was inflation is back. Inflation
right.
is back.
Yeah. Right.
The currency is a problem.
Right.
How much more can we tax incoming monies?
Right.
Those are real concerns.
And how do they handle that without raising interest rates and then bringing in, you know, much more capital than they necessarily, hot money than
hot
they
money.
Want?
And the interest rates are as high as they are in the world.
They are, and the currency is a problem. The interest rates are a problem in great measure because spending is so high, government spending. And that was one of the main reasons why Brazil was one of the last ones into the crisis and one of the first ones out, was because they had the reserves to spend, and they did. And they really hyper-capitalized BNDES, the development bank, and they were lending like crazy. They were investing in a number of infrastructure projects. And, you know, Brazil at this point, which was all, you know, generally good, and that's why Brazil really reacted as well to the crisis as they did, but they're going through a process right now. President Dilma recently announced that they're going to be cutting $50 billion out of the budget, and where they're really having to say, okay, where do we cut back? And a lot of that is in public sector jobs, which is not always the politically easy thing to do, but is incredibly necessary to deal with the currency issue. The other two bottlenecks I think that I would flag are the tougher ones. I mean, infrastructure, obviously, which we're talking about here, and then also education, because as Brazil is really taking itself to the next level economically, you've got a number of companies that have announced major R&D centers in Brazil just over the last year, both IBM and GE. Every company who wants to do anything of that level in Brazil is looking at how many PhDs they produce and how good are they. And so that's something that Brazil, you know, it's always been a challenge in Brazil, but they're really going to have to confront.
So, Julia, let me ask you one last question, and we're going to open it up for questions from the floor. Lula was the only former president of Brazil who didn't attend the lunch that Dilma hosted with Obama. And Kellie says that she's cutting back on social spending. Is there any danger that she's going to face any sort of internal problems within the PT? And she's also not poking the U.S. in the eye as dramatically as Lula did in the last couple of years. Is her base secure and strong if Lula, you know, starts becoming King Lear? Could she face any sort of backlash from the more radical elements of PT?
That's the biggest looking glass question that you've asked. And I was going to answer your other question about what are the problems, but her base is bigger than the PT, and her approval ratings have actually grown since she's taken office. And you see, Sao Paulo voters who voted for Sarah now polling in favor of her because they see, I mean, it's a certain sense a class bias maybe, but the new middle class is supporting her and not for ideological grounds. So I think she's actually expanding her base, and I would assume there would be some pushback, and you know, I would also within the PT, but I would hope that her relationship with President Lula is such that she would be able to use him as a resource to manage the PT. But I don't know the inside story of why he didn't attend.
Because she didn't call him personally, and protocol at Itamaraty, the foreign ministry, did, and he was insulted. He didn't get a personal phone call, is what they tell me. The issue here, Bernie, is a very important one. Lula can run again in 4 years. And you may have seen the story in the New York Times this morning about Medvedev and Putin mm-hmm. having a big falling out. That is what I am most concerned about, that the PT operatives may begin to pressure Lula to take back the presidency and put the PT back in power because she's really not trustworthy, they will say. And Lula is has a large ego, and in a sense he made Brazil during his 8 years, he thinks, in the office. And so as he moved down, there are no elections until the municipals, which 1 year before the nationals, we'll then have to see how this all begins to fall out. That is probably what I'd be most concerned about, that Lula suddenly announces his candidacy for the presidency again in 2.5 or 3 years, unless there's some kind of dialogue behind the scenes. And if Dilma succeeds with 2014, that'll be the first test, I think she's fine. But if she can't get the process moving, then she's going to have problems, because that is much more important, 2014, the soccer finals, than the Olympics. The Olympics are for the Alta Burguesia. The soccer finals are for the povão, and that's got to be done very, very carefully, or else there is going to be fallout.
I do think, though, that what Julia is saying on the approval ratings is important. I think that you know, Dilma knows what she's good at and knows what she isn't good at. She knows she's very good at administering and governing, and she's not good at the big politics, the charisma politics that Lula engages in. And so she's very focused on showing good government and in trying to get public support, given the demands that Brazil has in the next 6 years or so, getting public support for that good government and really trying to increase her base of support, as Julia said, beyond politics due to competence.
Before we open it up, I would be interested what your answer was going to be about what the biggest danger is.
Well, I want to just, I don't think this is the biggest danger at all, but I do think something to watch that I'm watching that I think is very interesting is, you joked about Paraguay, but just to think, and I'm not going to talk about Paraguay, but to just think about how Brazil adjusts to being the big power in the neighborhood and how the neighbors adjust to Brazil having that role financially, commercially, in terms of security. I mean, the creation of new regional institutions. One of the things that's differentiates this from the previous administration is the kind of unabashed statements that South American integration is Brazil's strategic priority, that Brazil has lots of global interests and will play globally, but that the South America environment is critical. Watching that, I think, is very, very, very interesting. And you know, 10 countries on Brazil's borders, vast asymmetries, the kinds of sort of security issues that we haven't talked about so much today, but where we see Brazil, for example, playing an increasing role in Bolivia with the DEA out, dealing with coca filtering through Brazil as a transit point and as a consumption place. I mean, these are kind of grinding long-term problems, but the overall environment in South America, President Obama highlighted how well things are going, but there are also some of the transnational issues that I think Brazil will increasingly face.
Okay. I can make just two comments, very short, as an example of the good side of this. There were two issues, one with Paraguay and one with Bolivia. And what the Plan Alto did, Paraguay was Itaipu, the large hydroelectric power project, and President Lugo wanted more income. Correctly so. And the second was, of course, the nationalization of Petrobras' holdings in Bolivia. What the Plan Alto did, and Lula did, he called the President Morales of Bolivia to Brasilia immediately, negotiated, gave him a big lunch and some money, and sent him home. No problem so far. And President Lugo of Paraguay was invited to Brasilia, received it with head of state honors, cash transfer, no more problems with Paraguay. But Julie's quite right. These border issues are going to be something to be watched very carefully.
Okay. So we'll open up for questions. Wait for the mic. Please stand and identify yourself, and please ask a question and not make a speech.
Thank you very much. Jeannie Tungara, Howard University. One area of concern is one that you just addressed, Julia. Thank you very much for that. And it has to do with the security partnership that we saw played out through Brazil's participation with UN forces to so-called protect Haitians. During the wave of civil unrest that resulted in mass killings and by the UN forces and also of Lavalas supporters in particular, and the departure of Aristide. So the question is twofold. One, what is the perception, or what was the perception of Brazil's neighbors about their actions as members of UN forces in Haiti at the request of the United States? And secondly, how will this U.S.-Brazil security partnership be shaped going forward?
Well, Brazil is heading MINUSTA in Haiti not at the request of the United States, but under U.N. Security Council mandate. I see you rolling your eyes. I mean, and I think you might know the answer to your question, and I'll confess not to be able to tell you how Brazil's neighbors react to its presence in Haiti. I mean, I know how Brazil sees itself there, and of course its narrative is a very positive one. Brazil is there with Chile, with Uruguay, with a big multinational force that includes the United States, and that's an area of pretty impressive and long-standing and growing presence for Brazil.
This gentleman, I think, over there, did you have a question? Well, seems to be preoccupied. Go ahead.
Thank you. Alan Wendt. I don't think any of you mentioned environmental issues. One reads a lot about them. Do they constitute a significant constraint on Brazil's development? I'm thinking, for example, of deforestation.
Deforestation has dropped dramatically under the administration of President Lula. They're very concerned about it. It's very hard for us to understand since we don't have an Amazon Valley. Now, the Amazon Valley is part myth, it's part culture, it's part history. It's a symbol of Brazil, and Brazilians are very concerned about it. And I think they finally are taking this very seriously, and I would expect that President Dilma will continue with his policy. Now, this means that Brazil will need to be a major, major participant in whatever arrangements we take as we move forward on carbon emissions. Copenhagen didn't work very well, Cancun didn't work very well, but the Brazilians are very concerned that they will need to be at the table because of the Amazon, and they are understanding more and more the average Brazilian, the Amazon is at the heart of what is going to happen with carbon emissions.
Brazilians have among the high, just a tiny footnote to that, the highest environmental consciousness in the world. If you look at the Pew ratings, Brazilians rate environmental sustainability, climate change is one of their top concerns on the global front. It's a kind of great moment because these major infrastructure projects, the pre-sol findings, the new hydropower facilities that they want to build, all have, in varying degrees, significant environmental consequences. And there's a consciousness and a willingness to address them going forward. It's very imperfect. I don't want to gloss over it. It's quite imperfect, but...
In addition, they do have one of the cleanest, they're very proud of this, they have one of the cleanest energy matrices in the world, about 80%, depends on what numbers you see, anywhere from 70 to 80% of their electricity comes from hydro. And even at that, if you look just 5 years ago, when you would talk to government officials about alternative energy, you know, be it wind or solar, geothermal, they'd say, oh, we've got the cleanest energy matrix in the world, look at all of our hydro, we're fine. You're not seeing that anymore. Really, over the last 2 years, you've seen more and more a real strategic approach to alternative energy sources. Nuclear, they're obviously reevaluating, as I think most folks are post-Japan, but still very committed to it, as well as a very ambitious wind energy program. So I think that'll continue, and I see some of the EPA folks who are on the presidential delegation are here as well, and I know that was a robust part of the agenda for the president's trip also.
I think it's important to point out that Marina Silva, who was the environmental minister and resigned from Lula's cabinet, ran for the presidency. We all expected Marina would get 9%, 10%. She got 19, almost 20%, and a large part of that was the average middle-class Brazilian understanding. She spoke for what they believed in, the energy and the environment.
Yeah, go ahead. No, you, sir. Yeah.
Darius Manns. My question is about state dominance in the economy. Yesterday, the Financial Times reported that Dilma is looking to remove the chairman and CEO of Vale, the number two mining conglomerate in the world, because they would like to see Vale play a much greater role at home rather than push its agenda for becoming competitive internationally. What does this trend, what does it mean for you?
This is a dynamic that started, frankly, under President Lula. And specifically with Vale, and I would say writ large amongst the Brazilian, the new multi-Brasis, they say, the multinational Brazilian companies, of a real pressure to, okay, as you expand internationally, that's fine, keep on growing, but hey, make sure you're investing here. If you're buying ships, buy them from Brazilian ship makers. If you're going to create jobs, create them here. Does any of this sound familiar to those of us that live in Washington? Yeah. So you had a dynamic, and again, this is under President Lula, where you had companies like Vale, like Ambev, Sagia. You had companies that were real icons of the Brazilian private sector, taking out full-page ads in Brazilian newspapers with pictures of Brazilians in their hard hats. If it's Vale, we employ Brazilians working for Brazil, and so it almost was kind of their own internal marketing to their own internal audience, being Planalto Palace, of look, we're still investing in Brazil. And so I think that what you see right now is a hangover from that previous dynamic. And if you look at the Brazilian press today, Chief of Staff Pelosi, Chief of Staff to President Dilma, very quickly came out and said, no, we didn't try to do anything. We aren't trying to intervene. And then there's a bit of kind of back and forth, if you will, in Brasilia right now on this. So we'll see how it shapes out. But, certainly, and this, is part of kind of the PT legacy, as Riordan says, having a stronger state role in various economic functions, be it, the weaker regulatory system with more political influence, et cetera. These are all things that have been traditional hallmarks of the PT and things that, market watchers and investors are obviously watching very closely with respect to the Dilma administration as well.
I'm Maureen Lewis from the World Bank, and this is a really interesting panel. I think that you did a really nice job of laying things out on Brazil. I wanted to go back to this issue on the competitiveness agenda and what it really means, because part of it is this dependence on commodities. But when you get into competing with China, some of it is what Kellie mentioned, having to do with very high-tech innovation and getting the universities to actually work with the private sector, which has not always been so easy. But the other part is that if you're going to focus on SMEs, you've got to really have a much better focus on education more broadly. and looking at what that means for driving services, because that's where they're going to compete probably most effectively with China, because they can't, they're not going to compete on low-cost wages that China has, but they can on some of the services side, but it seems to be tied to some of these other issues. So basically, I've got a two-part question, is that is the competitiveness, am I understanding it fully? And then what about these other two issues of the SMEs and the education link there? Because that's a chronic problem in Brazil and something they haven't really quite mastered, it seems to me. And it has implications in terms of being competitive.
No, I agree. I mean, I agree with what you said. I think it is going to be a big challenge. And, you know, I think part of the challenge of addressing it well is also the distractions and the very real pressures of having to deliver these global events and having to deliver real infrastructure improvements, and where does education fall in that, and how quickly do they focus on it?
The real issue is that Brazil has terrible public schools at the primary and secondary level and superb higher education. So what you do if you're middle class, you send your children, of course, to private schools, then they take the vestibular, the entrance exam, and go to the superb, non-paying, tuition-paying public universities. It's perverse. I mean, talk to FIESP, which I do all the time, the Federation of Industry of São Paulo. What they can't find are enough public school, high school graduates who can read manuals, operate technology, and do the kinds of things to be competitive. And, you know, you read, as well I do, the World Economic Forum's report on competitiveness, and the education box is where Brazil falls very badly on public education.
Is that something that Dilma...
Problem is that the education budget is passed by who? The Congress. And therefore, the members of Congress all want their children who are going to private schools, primary and secondary, to go to these marvelous public free universities. And so to get the budget recast is a real political battle. It's going to be very difficult to do, I think.
Oh, my mic died. Okay, fine. Sorry.
Any mic problem?
There you go. Good afternoon. I'm Rick Johnston with Citigroup. Should we be anticipating the possibility of some reforms in the tax area? Every time you talk about problems in Brazil that hamper and burden and hold it back, it's its tax regime. I don't know why you're laughing, but I hope it's funny.
The second argument you get around over a Caipirinha in Brazil is why isn't there a tax treaty between the two countries? It's unfathomable to most people why there isn't. I mean, there are obviously obstacles on both sides of the table. Yes, they certainly. If you read, you know, the good stuff that, say, someone like Chris Garman writes at Eurasia, he is of the mind, and I admire Chris's work, that is an area that Dilma would like to move forward on. No evidence yet, but that's something she understands, you know, is part of what we call the custo do Brasil, the cost of doing business in Brazil. And if you can't deal with those structural problems and just dabble at the top, then frankly the medium long term doesn't look as good as we'd hope it would look.
I do think that though she's realistic about what she can achieve, and that if anything is able to be achieved, it will be a simplification in some way, shape, or form, as opposed to a overall reform and recasting, which can be helpful on the margins, but when you really get to competitiveness and an impact on that, probably it's not all you need.
This side of the room.
Oh, okay.
Go left, right.
Go ahead.
Rob Cortell with Intellix. You've talked about the broad macro issues and you've talked about education, but what you've not talked about is sort of the social issues in the cities and crime drugs and kidnappings and all the rest of that. And I'd appreciate hearing a little bit of where you think that's going to go and how they're going to get a handle on it.
Well, that's my second photo up.
We call you Professor Rob.
That's right. There is the president and the first lady in the Cidade de Deus. They could not have gone there 2 years ago. This is one of the favelas, the slums, that's been reclaimed by the government, and security is moving in the right direction. And there was no problems with security with the president and first lady going to the Cidade de Deus, which is a famous film as well, where everyone kills everybody else, with 14-year-olds murdering their friends. No problem. Security still continues to be an issue and a problem, but the government has really begun to take this very seriously, in part because of 2014 and 2016. They realize that security is an issue for tourists. You know, it's not going to move as quickly as we would all like, but quite clearly it is moving for the first time, and they're putting real money into it. It'll take time, and it can't be done overnight, But I think the government, state governments of Rio de Janeiro and São Paulo are very much aware that they really have to cooperate now, federal, state, municipal participation in this program. And it isn't as costly as we would think. You know, talking to my Carioca friends over the last few days, it's extraordinary how mentally things are changing in Rio de Janeiro. We didn't think we could ever do it. Look, the government is actually doing it. You now can go to the Cidade de Deus without being shot or kidnapped or mugged. And that is a very important psychological difference in Brazil. You know, and I think Brazilians react to those kinds of things a good deal more emotionally than we do. And they're very, very pleased with the way things are going. Lots to be done yet, but so far, so good.
Let me ask you a related question, though. You know, most of the violence in Latin America, aside from street crime, is driven by the drug cartels. When I was Assistant Secretary, Brazil was hardly relevant to the drug issues. It was Colombia, Peru, Bolivia, to some extent, transit over Mexico and Guatemala. To what extent are the traffickers now moving into Brazil? Is that a trend that's accelerating? So this criminal, corrupt, violent issue is going to be a larger agenda for Brazil, or is it more the historic legacy of these gangs that have controlled these neighborhoods?
I think it already is more of an issue. I think that, I mean, when Julia made reference to Brazil getting more involved in Bolivia, it's exactly for that reason, because this is really the first time in Brazil's history that Brazil is having to deal with the fact that, you know, it's not a transit point or anything of that nature for drugs. They're having drug use issues in Brazil. And if you look, you know, just even 10 years ago at how Brazilian customs, for example, would handle examinations of goods as they would come across the border, the only thing, not the only, but the main thing that they would worry about is, was the tax paid, was the tariff paid? And if you look now, they've actually had to recast the way that they're defining risk assessment, because they're having to, as we do, be much more, you know, sensitive to the trafficking of drugs and such. You've got the, all of the strengthening of the border controls also for that same reason. So they've had to react very quickly. I think that they are trying to react quite quickly to that and responsibly, because they want to try to nip it in the bud before it gets to a Colombia or a Mexico sort of situation.
The military came out with a new national security doctrine about 18 months ago that nobody reads except professors, because they have to have their students read it.
And their students.
I know. And a very important part of the new security doctrine are the frontiers and the Amazon. They're redeploying forces, they are buying new equipment, and they're very concerned about exactly the issues that you raised. So they're very much aware of it, and I think they're trying to deal with it in a very intelligent and straightforward way.
And just as a tiny footnote, and to answer your second question in terms of the U.S.-Brazil defense cooperation agreement, cooperation on security front, there's a lot of sensitive legacy issues when you get into what the United States is doing, and they're not just legacy issues for Latin America. Having the United States involved in the security dimension of anything is touchy. It's sensitive. It touches chords, as you well know. It's not large, it's not extensive, but by comparison to where things were 10 years ago or even 5 years ago, between the United States and Brazil, a great deal more discussion, cooperation on the technical front, satellite imagery, a number of other fronts with respect to the security dynamic and transnational criminal networks that both Brazil and the United States are dealing with.
Okay, since I slided this side of the room, I'm going to give you a second. No, yeah, right here. Give your affiliation as well as your name if you can.
Hello, my name is Jerry Johnson with RLJ Equity Partners. I had a question just about infrastructure. Just given the Olympics and the World Cup coming up, just the need for airports, roads, and I think even for the Olympics, there's talk of bringing cruise ships into Rio because there are not enough hotels. Does Brazil have the resources in terms of people, companies in place to undertake such a large infrastructure development in such a short period of time? And then B, do you think there'll be a tangible impact if they are not able to pull this off by the Olympics and World Cup?
I mean, the last 10 days I was in three of the airports in Brazil, in Rio and São Paulo, Congonhas, Guarulhos, and Jobim or Galeão. They are truly third-rate airports, and Dilma's aware of that. Now, what is going to happen, I think, is there's going to be a great deal more public-private partnering to get this done and give a lot of this over to the private sector to break down the really inefficient and incompetent part of the military that runs the airports and don't know what they're doing, But is it going to be done in time? That's the issue. And I think it's a real concern. Why I said Dilma is going to be an internal president, because she understands 2014 and 2016 are absolutely critical. And it's just not, as you know, it's ports, it's railroads, it's getting that train built between Sao Paulo and Rio de Janeiro. And the president and the two presidents agreed that the U.S. would be very helpful in getting Brazil ready for 2014 and 2016. And that, I think, is an area in which the United States can be seen as very, very positively involved in Brazilian development. I hope that the administration carries that forward as quickly and as publicly as possible.
And the Rio state and other governments are hustling. I mean, while the president was speaking at the Teatro Municipal on Sunday, where Riordan was, basically, you know, most of the important folks on a Sunday in Rio, and it was sunny, were talking to the private sector delegation, really trying to sell us on the opportunities, and it covered all the different areas that you touched upon. So I think, you know, I couldn't agree with Riordan more. People are very, very focused on it, but it will be an issue of running against the clock.
And President Obama did mention that he appreciated the audience on Sunday because there was a Vasco Botafogo game that afternoon. As you know, football is a nightmare in Brazil unless you're a Brazilian. And so people did show up and didn't stay home to watch the football game.
Just this side, but nobody on that side has a question. Go ahead.
Thank you so much. The ambassador of Cote d'Ivoire, but I'm here because I just recently arrived from Brazil. So I'm still interested in Brazilian issues. And I just want to thank you for all this information you are giving to the people about that big country. The issue on which I just want to intervene is one aspect of the Brazilian recent story is the issue of democracy, because I was there when the election happened, and by the time they were organizing the election, the popularity of the outgoing president was still about 80%. And when you are in an area where the people, let's say the president, has the possibility of saying that you want to modify the constitution and continue, but instead, President Lula accepted to stop his mandate and support Dilma to become the new president, and the transition went very democratically. And when you come from a country like Cote d'Ivoire, where the loser of the election want to become the president, I think that you are there to mention that the issue of democracy is a key issue that should be credited on the account of Brasilia. That's what I want to mention, because I arrived from Brazil, let's say, 8th of February this year.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so you should mention that it is very important for the developing countries and for the intermediary countries too. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Mr.
And to compliment that, we should point out in Brazil, when you vote, there are no hanging chads. that the Brazilian voting system is extraordinarily efficient. It is a national system, not state-run, and more importantly, they use U.S. technology, which we don't use ourselves in the United States.
Is our technology from China?
Could be. Turn it over.
Oh,
made in China.
It's from Ohio.
This gentleman here. I think Ohio. Right behind you. Yeah.
John Barino, Covington and Burling. You mentioned Brazil's concerns with China, many of which the U.S., same concerns the U.S. has. My question is there any reason to believe that there'd be more collaboration between Brazil and the U.S. on those issues, or would you expect each to keep plying away in their separate tracks?
Well, another of our students from SAIS, his name is Tim Geithner, flew to, where am I got brand, they go to support the brand, flew to Brasilia to try to get the Brazilians to have a joint position with regard to the Chinese and the finance minister came out and said, we're having as much problem with you and your QE2 as we are with the Chinese, so back off, basically. No, I don't think they will be.
But I think, though, that there's not a unified view in the Brazilian government on it, too.
Not.
I think that Minister Montega, the finance minister, is much more radical.
Out in front.
Yeah, out in front is a better way to put it, on this issue than others. And you know, but to Rune's point, we are not going to hold hands and sing kumbaya on China. I mean, they're their number one export destination right now. So the Brazilians are going to be very, very ginger. But again, I think that's what I liked about the raising of the level of a number of the dialogues in the context of the president's trip is that, you know, hopefully it will give us more and more senior opportunities to have productive discussions so that we can, you know, getting back to Bernie's Chinese menu, you know, find the areas on the menu where we can collaborate.
I do think we may, without calling it explicit cooperation with respect to China currency, we might find that Brazil and the United States are increasingly sounding the same notes, if not exactly singing kumbaya together. The issue is quite similar for both countries, and coordinating messages or joint statements may never come to pass, but both countries reflecting publicly in the same direction would be a significant departure from even where we were a year ago.
Carl Hausman from Bunge. You had mentioned that one of the objectives of Brazil is to be treated as an equal by the United States. Could you give some specific policy examples of where they would like equal treatment, and comment what would be the U.S.'s reaction and our willingness to make space for them?
Well, the important one that both presidents mentioned, you know, was greater participation and representation, you know, of the major emerging market economies, of which Brazil is very important, at the World Bank and the IMF, and that's beginning to move in the right direction. I think that at the end of the George W. Bush administration, we resuscitated the G20 precisely to include the Chinese, the Indians, and the Brazilians, and on those various summits, Washington, London, Pittsburgh, Brazilians have been very outspoken with regard to a new financial architecture. And as Kellie pointed out, President Lula commented time and again, we were the last one into the financial crisis, the last country out. Why? Because we had good regulatory frameworks, our banking system was a lot sounder than the U.S. and Europe, and those are the kinds of things they would like to be recognized. And of course, as Julia mentioned, we've all mentioned environment. The Brazilians really believe they can bring a great deal to the table on the environmental talks. And remember, in Copenhagen, President Obama had a knock on the door and asked to join the final drafting of the communique. Who was at the table? South Africans, the Chinese, the Indians, and the Brazilians. So we're seeing the BRIC movement, which we haven't talked about a great deal. I realize it's a skeptical concept to some people. But the BRIC movement is indeed going to be one I think the Brazilians will support very strongly. It's not a new NATO. It's not any kind of a defense league. But it is, I think, a common interest on the part of the major emerging market economies that the industrial countries will need to deal with.
We have time for one more question if anybody has anything they're burning. Mark.
So Margaret Daly Hayes, I'd be interested in your assessment of how the private sector, both Brazil, especially Brazilian, but Brazilian and international, see the Dilma government and the PT government. You mentioned earlier that under Lula there was kind of a government grew a lot, and indeed, Bene the SA has been investing in firms, so taking more state weight in some of the local firms. What is the assessment of the private sector of the future for this government? What would they like to see change or stay the same in the Dilma / PT government, and perhaps whether those are this close or whether she is separating herself a bit from
I mean, I think she's definitely her own person in her own government, and I think that the private sector is assessing her as such. I think that there has been a great deal of approval of the very pragmatic way in which she's run the government thus far. Obviously, in an environment where Brazil is needing to invest to the extent that they are to prepare for these global events in infrastructure, et cetera, it makes for just amazing opportunities for private sector investment and growth. So overall, very optimistic, but also very watchful of some of those potentially more state involvement tendencies that can crop up from time to time.
The Liberal government talked a lot about private-public partnerships. Didn't really go very far, and for many reasons, the financial crisis, the electoral campaign. But what we've heard so far from Brasilia is that I think Dilma is very much in favor of this, particularly in the area of infrastructure, which the private sector is desperate to have happen. Roads, ports, railroads, airports.
Privatizing Infraero, which no one thought she would have done.
That's right, and privatizing.
She's been out there.
That's right, which is very important, I think. So far, the signs are very good, and I think very important.
Okay, we're going to have to wrap up. Since this is on the record, I expect we'll see a headline in tomorrow's paper, Brazil expert warns of impending Paraguayan invasion. But I just want to ask one last question of Julia. On a scale of 1 to 10, how hard or greater was Riordan?
Is 10 hard?
Yeah, 10 is the hardest of hard.
15.
Yeah. I would just ask everybody to please join me in thanking a terrific panel. Thank you very much.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.